Would you give Jonathan Ferguson the biggest God bless you today? The prophet of God. Come on.
Hallelujah. It did. I won't keep you long, amen. Can I get some more juice in this? Who am I talking to? Oh, he's on the camera. Give me some more juice in the mic. Sounds like a filter on the mic. It kind of sets a head where you can't go over it no matter how loud you scream. Let's take that off.
Folks, it's not just me. See, when I do that stuff, oh, he's so picky. Oh, he's just a perfection. The prophetic is the prophetic. All right? I said all right. But the prophet comes in and it's okay. It's okay. But when a man of God who's been here for 43 years, and come on, somebody, don't look at me in that religious tone of voice. Somebody shout, not in this house. We like excellence. Excellence. That's the prophetic. Excellence and order. The apostolic. Sorry, Jim. I will interrupt you again.
No. Let's honor God for Apostle Jim and Pastor Jonah. Amen. Keep giving me juice, juice, more juice, more juice, more juice, more juice. Amen. Excited to be here. You can be seated. Let's lift our hands and reverence His presence. Lord, we love You. Jesus, I surrender to You. You're the vine. We're the branches. Apart from You, we can do nothing. Your Father's the husbandman. Tend this garden, keep it, sustain it, develop it by the word You put in my mouth this morning. In Jesus' name, let a prophetic economy open up, a prophetic culture, apostolic prophetic community be developed even stronger. In Jesus' name. How are you? Put your hands down. Good to see you guys. I was talking to my friends from Cleveland, but it's good to see everyone. So I'm not going to keep you long. I'm going to sit and teach. I've been battling a cough. So if I scream and hopefully no mucus and nothing fly out of my mouth. That was a joke. Go to Acts 2. One of my favorite scriptures to come from. I keep hearing in my spirit prophetic economy. Now, economy is not dealing with just funds, currency. It's not dealing with just currency. It's dealing with, it can detail many different things. The health or the strength or the vibrancy of a thing. Acts 2, verse 17. Actually, verse 16. You ready for a word?
Yes.
So I'm going to tease you. Is my dad here yet? My dad is on the road on the way here. So you'll see him come in late. From Madison, Wisconsin. And my stepmom may be here tomorrow. They may come back. So you won't see him tonight. You'll only see him this morning. And he'll be alone, but they're supposedly coming back later. Amen. Can I just teach out of my reservoir? Is that okay? Okay, so let's start. Verse 15, I'm sorry. For these men are not drunken as you suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. It was 9 a.m. Four watches of the night, four watches in the morning. The watch begins at 6 p.m. because the evening and the morning are the first day. And it goes 3 hours each watch. Four watches. The last watch of the night, the fourth watch, ends at 6 a.m. begins the first watch of the morning. So the third hour of the day equals 9 a.m. So he's saying it's too early to be drunk. Did I lose you already? He said, these men are not drunken as you suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. It's too early for that. But this is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I pour out my spirit upon flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall what?
Prophesy.
And your young men see visions. And your old men do what?
Dream.
Now, is he saying old people are only going to dream and young people are only going to see visions? Where is his spirit being poured out?
All flesh.
All flesh. So what's the context of what he's explaining? This is for everybody. So he's emphasizing all flesh. He's including young men, old men, women, men, children, parents, everybody. Say all flesh.
All flesh.
If you have skin, he's going to put his spirit on your body. And some people say, well, I don't feel God today. Because after he put his skin on, after he put his spirit on your skin, it is so his spirit live in your body. So if you don't feel him, if you don't sense him, you can stir up the reality of who he is from within you. Someone say, I have skin. So I qualify. How many people have never had an encounter with God? Don't be ashamed. Well, let's do it the other way. How many people have had an authentic, beyond church, outside of a preacher, beyond someone laying hands on you, beyond someone prophesying to you, you've had a direct encounter with the Lord? Let me see your hands. And you know it was him. Now, this is what prophetic economies are for. To create cultures where what you have experienced can be released to everyone else. Because he wants to pour out his spirit on everybody. What God wants to do in the body of Christ is not supposed to stay in the body of Christ. Now, when I drove here, I passed some apartment complexes. And there are a lot of cars still over there. Matter of fact, there are more cars over there than over here. Now, the problem with that is we had 13,000 people watching. We made flyers. We over-advertised. We told people to tell your friends. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying how many. This is not about how many people are here. The point is, when they woke up this morning, They didn't need an advertisement to stay in the bed. They didn't need a Facebook announcement not to go to church. And that means hell is getting more results than the church. When in reality, we have something more and better to offer. I mean, wouldn't you say that what we have to offer is better than hell if we got nothing else? I mean, if you never got healed, it's still better than hell. If you never got a blessing, it's still better than hell. If you never saw a miracle, it's still better than hell. Now, we don't want to preach that because it shows us how much of a spoiled brat we have become to have the nerve. I said it, brat, and I may be talking to you if you're mad. You are the brat because you have the nerve when you get mad, when things don't go your way, I don't like that church anymore. What is wrong with you? Really? Seriously? Are you serious? I mean, when you compare the reality and the reasons we get offended at God and the reasons we leave church, and then we see the big picture, those things are not about us getting offended at God. And they're not about us leaving the church. Listen, there's enough room for somebody else to replace you if you want to leave. It's not about that. What it's about is hell is smart enough to distract you and break your focus to make sure you go to heaven by yourself. Come on. Ask your neighbor, are you going to heaven by yourself? Or are you depopulating hell? No, you should be deep. No, see this, we come to church. You know, the biggest critics of the church are the worst evangelists in the pew. The biggest critics in the church are the worst evangelists in the pew. Adding nothing, doing nothing. I don't know why I'm talking to someone like this, but I hope I'm making you mad. Nothing. And have the nerve to think that your tithe gives you a voice to critique and say what you don't like. No, keep your money. Give me my tithe. I'm just on the surface. We haven't gone deep yet. God wants to pour his spirit out on all flesh. And if people are not experiencing him, you may be the hindrance. Are we in the way or are we in the way? No, it was called the way in the scripture. Those who followed the way. And I've been in the way for 20 years. Exactly. You've been in the way. Let's wake up. Let's realize what's happening. We're having church and they're sleeping. We're having church and they're barbecuing. We're having church and they're watching the NBA games. Is it really that we're boring? Do we not have anything else to do with our life? Do we I'm sure we can think of at least 10 things we can be doing right now. Right? So what is it that they're hooked on that's better than what we have to offer? Or are we just plain lazy? Take our time. I don't feel like it today. It's raining. I don't like the praise and worship. I'm going to take off this week. I'm on vacation. And you know you got back on Saturday night, and you're still on vacation. Vacation? Seriously? Oh, I see. You work a 40-hour week, and you can't give God two of them. Vacation? No, you got your breakthrough, your paycheck. You put 40 hours of prayer into FedEx, and you want an acceleration breakthrough from a laying on of hands that you don't even respect the authority of the office they carry. Double-minded man is unstable. You know what double-minded means? It's one word in the Greek. It means double-souled. You seen the movie Split? That's how church folk are. 50 personalities. I have a church me. I have a work me. I have a friend me. I have a family me. I have a family reunion me. I have a marriage me. I may have a mistress me. Don't look at your neighbor. Double-minded. Because somewhere our focus has gotten off. Fell into a vista. Seek the kingdom first. It's a priority. Get your focus right. Then all things. In other words, you can't have two lives. You can't have two agendas. It's either God's agenda or no agenda. My dad just walked in. It's my dad. I need my children to grow up. Y'all clap better for him than me. No, I'm messing. Well, my dad is a Bible whiz. Very successful in what he does. What kind of consulting do you do? Real estate software consulting. He's done business analysis, business analysts and all kind of everything he's done, he's gotten certified on his own to do it. And made some good money. Yep. So when my dad didn't finish school, I saw him go study at the library. And he proved that there was no excuse not to be successful. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so prophetic economy, prophetic culture. God wants this house to become a culture where when people come in, and that's going to be the smallest part that you focus on, they're going to have an undeniable encounter with God that is irresistible for them to stay away from. But more so than that, when you leave here, you carry a irresistible presence that people who would never come here cannot deny. Someone say, I want it.
I want it.
So when you're dealing with the prophetic, and this is what God's going to open up, if I kept reading, I was going to say sons and daughters would prophesy in verse 17. And everything that happened in the upper room was a manifestation of God establishing a prophetic culture so his spirit can be poured out on all flesh. So when you're dealing with the prophetic, you got to deal with more than just prophesying. What is God raising up in his church? He's raising up Revelations 19 and 10, which is one branch of sphere of the prophetic, which says the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. So whenever the prophetic and the apostolic leaves who Jesus is, it becomes faulty. It becomes twisted. It becomes churchy. And even becomes religious. The Lord warned me, he said, tell the apostolic and prophetic church to be careful they don't become the new Pharisees. You can be the new old thing. Just because it's a new style doesn't mean it's a new thing. Just because it's a new brand doesn't mean it's a new thing. You can put old wine in new wineskins. The wine represents the move of the spirit. The wineskin represents the methodology or the system or the formula or the model or the blueprint that the move of the spirit functions in. So you can have a new, you can have a new style or brand or method in the way you do church. Like we have cool backgrounds now. We used to have really high steeples. That's a new wineskin. But if you're still putting the old wine in a new wineskin, it's still going to break the system. It's not going to be operational. God's not going to be able to do with it what he wants to do with it. It's new music, but it's old anointing. It's new style, but it's old. It's just old, outdated, flip phone type of technology in the spirit. You need an iPhone. Okay, that was a commercial. So, the prophetic keeps the body of Christ updated with current technology in the spirit. The world is changing every 3 years. And the reason we don't reach them is because we don't have an upgrade in our expression. And the demons we fight today are not the same demons we fought 5 years ago. I remember when homosexuality, it was a joke. Now, if we're not careful, it will become a fad. Like people who were lesbian or homosexual in my high school, just like 16, 17 years ago, they were scared to even come out of the closet. Now you have LGBTQSTYZS, and they still add letters. And they have rights and have the nerve to call it civil rights. All right, we're going to get off that subject. But we're not fighting the same powers, so we can't use the same weaponry. I would not go over to Russia and try to take out Putin with a bow and arrow. He needs a sniper, not a battle axe. So we're in a current culture with an outdated expression of who God is. When we should not be fighting to be relevant, we should be ahead of the game. You know, by the time business leaders release what they call trade secrets, this is stuff they've already known to work, and it already made as much money as it can make, and they already own new secrets, which is why it's called trade secrets. It's supposed to be secret while it's secret, because it's supposed to make the money who make the people the money who know the secrets. So by the time you get the secret, by the time you join Mary Kay, Mary Kay already made her money. So we're behind schedule. I don't want you to climb the pyramid. I want you to build the pyramid, Moses, and tell Pharaoh, let my bring them out of Egypt and create a system in the middle of a wilderness? Can you go in a desert and watch me erect the garden? Can you go in the wilderness and watch me create a paradise? I want a people that I can raise up with prophetic power to bring into existence creatively, innovatively, what does not exist yet, to speak what hasn't been spoken, to hear what hasn't been heard, and to create what hasn't been created, to do what no man has ever seen before. Someone say that's prophetic. So they don't listen to us because we're outdated. We're still fighting to be on Christian TV and they own networks. So how do we get back up to speed? They're prophetic, but the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. And this is where the enemy throws a snag in the prophetic expression, because it becomes about the apostolic and prophetic, and it becomes less about bringing people to Jesus. And it becomes about how deep you are, how good you can speak in tongues, how good you can prophesy, how much revelation you have. Oh, that was a good sermon. Like some of y'all today, y'all liking what I'm saying, but half of you won't do nothing with what I said. You don't need a new word. You need to apply the word you've already gotten. And the nerve of the apostolic and prophetic community to have the nerve to say what's religious and forget it was that same Baptist church you were in when you got saved. No, don't forget you got raised up in the Catholic church. Now all of a sudden every church is religious because it's not the new fad. Because it's not the new style. God doesn't have to move in the confines of what we call modern church. He's still moving in Lutheran churches. I'll be at one tomorrow. He's still moving in Presbyterian churches. I preached in them before. He's still moving in Catholic churches. My dad came out of a Catholic church and got filled with the Holy Ghost. God, we've seen the wineskin. Where's the wine? So the prophetic is it monitors the move of the Spirit to make sure the wine is really there. It's easy to go throughout the motions, but what is the current move of the Spirit? And can you detect it? And when you detect it, can you articulate it? Can you communicate it? Someone say that's prophetic. So there's one technology you need that the prophetic brings about, and that's the full manifestation of all the gifts of the Spirit. Because if you're going to be prophetic and represent who Jesus is in the earth, and if everything apostolic and prophetic you do is supposed to lead to someone else being saved, being converted, and being discipled so that they can be trained and matured and go back out and get someone else saved and converted and discipled and matured so they can go back out and get someone else saved and converted. In other words, this church can literally, if everyone catch the spirit of prophecy that God is releasing in this house, it can literally triple in 3 months. This house, and that's an understatement. That's like 0.00000009997%. That was a joke. I need y'all to laugh at my jokes. The old church says, show some sign. Say amen. Okay, so that's a low percentage of what God can do in a short period of time. If you caught that spirit of prophecy. You know, they didn't have Facebook in Jesus' days. But people would travel from 5 different regions by word of mouth. One person. You know, Jesus wasn't trying to be popular. He was telling people to keep it secret. But it was so spectacular what he was doing They couldn't hold it. He would say, shut up, don't tell nobody. I said, okay, I'm not going to tell nobody. And by the time they got around the corner, just. Now we say, please tell them. Please bring them. Because we don't understand what we have. You don't have to beg people to endorse the real thing. If you really tasted this the way you, maybe we still so focused on our problems and want to get a word just to get out of the deep waters that we forgot what we really have. Maybe you're looking at me, wanting me to give you some new revelation, and you forgot that the Spirit that spoke the Son into existence ain't coming out of my mouth, it's sitting in your belly. I know you don't always feel him. I know you don't always feel your best. I know you don't always have good days, but that don't mean nothing. It means that the Spirit of God is hovering over a deep place and brooding over darkness and is about to call light out of a dark place. Stop running away from problems and crisis and conflict and realize that God can push you in a dark place to call some light out of it. No, that thing ain't about to take you out and kill you and shut you down. That thing is about to stir up creative power in you. And when you speak, let there be, you're going to create something out of nothing. We've forgotten what we have. We've forgotten what we have. We've forgotten what we have. So we submit to the culture. Be surprised, football season, basketball season. All right, y'all, we're going to have church early. I was on Super Bowl Sunday this year, preaching in Dallas, Texas. 5-hour morning service. The game had started. Nobody left because God opened the blind eyes of a lady who had been blind for 11 years. Now, why am I sitting up there and watch somebody else get paid, and I'm sitting up here raising the dead, healing the sick, cleansing the leper? I ain't got to watch you get sick. I don't need your entertainment. God's about to show a power in the world that's going to be greater than anything they can run to. Y'all quiet in this church. I thought we would have had at least 30 more amens than that. That was anointed too. Someone's left leg is giving you problems. When I looked in this area, I saw it. I don't know if it's over here. Is this you? It's like a pain from like your right below your hip, shooting down past your calf muscle. So it's both of you on here. Can both of you just stand up? Does it cause a crook in the way you, the limp in the way you walk? Is it something crooked there? Lift your hands and pray in the Holy Ghost for a second. Lord, be straightened. We straighten this leg. There goes the mother in the blue shirt. The anointing is all over you. Touch. Fire on you. Fresh, 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 fresh. Now do it stronger, Lord. Give him more. Ooh, there it is. Now start moving that leg. Start moving that leg. That's all over her. Do something that would have caused pain. It feels amazing.
Come on! Come on! Come on!
Come on, give him a shout! Mother in the blue shirt, the prophetic word of the Lord rests in your mouth. the prophetic word of the Lord rest in your mouth.
She prophesied Wednesday night. She prophesied Wednesday night.
She prophesied Wednesday night.
Wednesday night. She prophesied Wednesday night. Fire. She prophesied fire. Woo. Wednesday night.
There is an angel that stands to your right now that's going to accompany you in this next place of prayer. The strength of your prophecy will be the strength of your intercession. And you'll begin to pray things by the spirit of intercession. And you will begin to speak things out of your prayer. The Lord says you will need to write or record, because things you will not be aware of when you pray them, you'll see them in the news media. And you'll speak. God is giving you and entrusting you a greater measure in the prophetic, so that as you're faithful to speak the things you see in prayer here, it's almost as if your measure in the prophetic is going to grow with the measure that the church is going to grow with. You be faithful to speak the things that God shows you around Chicago. Pain, go. No, no, you're not coming back. You're not coming back. Loose her in Jesus' name. That spirit of infirmity just tried, like, it just tried to almost like crawl back up your leg. But we rebuke it. And now the thief be discovered, he must pay you back. This wasn't a leg pain. This was a spirit of infirmity. It's almost like the doctors don't even know what that is, where it's coming from. It was a spirit of infirmity. I saw that spirit just trying to crawl back up your leg, but God rebuked it. He rebuked the day of evil. Rebuke the day of evil. Rebuke the day of evil. Rebuke the day of evil. That's prophetic. Rebuke the day of evil. Will you rise with me and just declare that in the atmosphere that he'll rebuke the day of evil? Come on, jump on your feet and start declaring that in the spirit. We rebuke the day of evil. We rebuke the day of evil. We rebuke the day of evil. We rebuke. Come on, raise your voice. We rebuke the day of evil. Come on, raise your voice. Raise your voice. We rebuke the day of evil. Tell them to the Oh, we curse the day of evil. Now listen, when I flew into Chicago, I felt, I sensed, and I saw a dark cloud over it. The Lord says, in the days to come, in the times to come, what shall hit this city? This house shall be a light post. This is what? It would almost be as if between this suburb and the greater Chicago, a state line was drawn.
Straight line.
A state line.
A state line.
In the spirit, a dominion will be established. And certain powers won't be able to cross this line. Ha! Face! I wish you'll shout louder than that. Stay here. Vey levando vey la suve. Come on, lift your hands and lift your voices. Vey la da da tova vada montovia. We establish jurisdiction. We establish
aligned in the spirit, do not cross here. Murder will not cross here. Crisis will not cross here. Disaster will not cross here. For I raise this house up as a Goshen, and I raise this house up as a secret place, a refuge, a city of defense, a defense city of praise and wall, a wall of fire around you, my glory in the middle. And I hedge you about with protection. Come on, lift those hands and pray in the Holy Ghost. Vela na batola vela la monturvias. Tekal ale batovia. Ili mandur vela sukava. Come on, pray. 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 Pray, pray, pray. Come on, lift those voices, lift those hands, lift those voices, lift those hands. Oh, la 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 fa la tole ve kia no ma vea surivea. Father, Lord, increase your measure this morning. I increase your measure this morning. And you will partner with heaven in your prayer. You will partner with angels in your declarations. And I give you this measure. Yeah, lift those hands. I give you this measure. Hmm. Now confiscate these souls from the grips of hell. I empower your hands to confiscate, to snatch them out of fire. Ge-da-da-da-tama. There goes, there's an impartation for the gifts of the Spirit. You will not just witness. You'll heal the sick. You'll cast out devils. You will prophesy. I'll give you words of knowledge. I'll show you their business. I'll cause you to read their mail. I'll give you insight and give you discernment. I'll cause you to see into their chamber. I'll cause you to know the thoughts of their hearts. You will prophesy and show them I'm real. Receive that. Receive that. Now, in the next 30 seconds, receive by impartation what you would have received by teaching. Dormant gifts inside of you are waking up right now. Lift your hands and receive it. Gifts of healing, working of miracles, discerning of spirits. There is a cloud on the left side of this room. Do you see that? It's moving. There is a visible cloud in them. Receive. Some of you are going to have the empowerment to see people receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Lift your hands. Fire be on you. Fire be on you. Fire be on you. To baptize with fire. To baptize with the Spirit. Now I'm going to stop here.
There's a dimension of the gifts of the Spirit that have to open in this prophetic culture economy. That economy is not just for power, and it's literally for an economy also. So that when things come in the world, your goods are safe and your possessions are safe. And hear the word of the Lord, that shall be your portion. It's going to be your portion. There's a whole community, kingdom community, that God's establishing through this house. And there's going to be a light post in this region where people can run in to be safe. A strong tower. And the righteous will run in and be safe. Olivia, we counsel every plan of the enemy to sabotage, to short circuit, to cut off, to steal, and to destroy this move of God. We quarantine it in Jesus' name. We're going to go up in the spirit tonight more. How many ready for tonight? I'm going to give this back to Apostle. There's a lot more I could have taught, but the spirit of prophecy to testify of Jesus, which is the very grace to evangelize with the prophetic power, with the prophetic strength, the gifts of the Spirit be imparted. One thing that prophecy can do is it can impart gifts. He said, "The stir up the gift or neglect not the gift that is within you that you received by the prophecy of the presbytery." And we would have taught all about that, but I just don't feel like we should do that now because of how the Spirit of God moved in a different direction. But what I did not teach, you've gained the impartation of it. Yes. And gifts... Yes. But gifts of the Spirit are being activated and stirred in you so that as you go and as you embrace the spirit of prophecy and as you embrace your responsibility to tell people about who Jesus is, you're going to do it in a power, and signs and wonders are going to follow you. And this is going to be a place where you can come and cultivate those gifts in growing those anointings. Amen. Say, "I receive." So let's receive Apostle Jim, and I'll see you guys tonight. Amen. I'm going to go right out. Amen.